Welcome back, Book Club Warriors. Kwe Tansei Sego Ani Buju. My name is Pam Palmiter, and this is my YouTube channel where we focus on educating the resistance and empowering the next generation of warriors to help us save our peoples and the planet. Today's book is not just a book, it's a damning expose of Canada as a police state. And for everyone that ever thought Native peoples were being paranoid about state surveillance, get ready to be blown away. And trust me, if there is one book you must read for 2020, this is it. So stay tuned. Welcome back, Reconciliation Book Club members. We are starting off 2020 with a book that puts us right in the middle of Canada's targeted policing and surveillance practices of Indigenous peoples. The book is called Policing Indigenous Movements, Dissent and the Security State, and it was written by Andrew Crosby and Jeffrey Monahan. The book was also published by Fernwood Publishing in 2018, and it has been making waves ever since. While I could try to summarize this book in a sentence or two, Fernwood does it much better. So here's the video promo for the book that you can find on Fernwood Publishing's YouTube channel.
This investigation project, Sitka, surveillance happens, is where these data banks are there, and they're mined post-facto.
The only thing that really concerns me is I don't want to be categorized as someone terrorizing people, because that is not what I did, that is not what I do.
Targeting Indigenous peoples as national threats. The only thing I've done is be critical of federal government land claims and self-government policies. They are concerned about my critique.
Indigenous peoples have historically been criminalized and targeted and labeled as terrorists.
Video was like a trailer for a major Hollywood movie or an episode of X-Files, complete with secret government agencies, spying on Native peoples, and if you read between the lines, a deep connection to the extractive industry. Trust me, this book, Policing Indigenous Movements, Dissent and the Security State, is as good as the Fernwood trailer. This book was published in 2018 by Fernwood Publishing and is available as a paperback book on Fernwood's website for $25 Canadian or as an EPUB book for the same price. It's also available in other online bookstores like Chapters and Amazon, and as usual, I'll post links in the description box below just in case you haven't read it yet. And if you have been with our Reconciliation Book Club since the beginning, you will know that I am a huge fan of Fernwood Publishing. They are a publishing company whose motto is critical books for critical thinkers, and their goal is to inform, enlighten, and challenge with a mandate that includes social change and social justice. I also like them because they specifically publish books that challenge the status quo, and in particular, challenge the devastating impacts of ongoing settler colonialism. Now, the authors of this book are Andrew Crosby and Dr. Jeffrey Monahan. Andrew is a coordinator with the Ontario Public Interest Research Group and is currently working on his PhD in the Department of Sociology and Anthropology at Carleton University. Jeffrey is an associate professor at Carleton's Institute for Criminology and Criminal Justice, where his research focuses on security governance, policing, and surveillance. Now, they're both considered experts in this area and have fine-tuned their access to information skills, effectively accessing government documents, thousands of them, that would never have otherwise been seen by the public. They're well-respected in their field, and their book, Policing Indigenous Movements, is backed up by their extensive and careful research. For those of you who are interested, I'll also post some links to their other published works and books in the description box below. Now, let's turn to the book itself. First, let me declare my bias. I am a super nerdy bookworm, researcher, and legal academic, and I am drawn to books that prove their claims. This book includes extensive academic references, as well as current media stories that many of us have already heard about. In addition to their academic research, the heart of their research are their numerous access to information requests, also known as ATIPs, to federal government departments and agencies like INAC, PCO, the RCMP, DND, and CSIS. Now, for my American viewers, INAC is Indian Affairs. Though they change their name every few years, everyone pretty much knows them as INAC. PCO is the Privy Council Office, and that office is mandated to support the Prime Minister and the Cabinet. The RCMP is the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, Canada's National Police Force. DND is the Department of National Defence, our military. And CSIS is the Canadian Security Intelligence Service. And while this is an academic-style book, I found that it was written in a way that's accessible to a large number of readers outside of an academic context. First of all, the book's only 194 pages and is divided into four chapters plus an introduction and a conclusion. Now, some might read this book a chapter a week or a chapter every day, but other avid readers could literally read this book in a day or even an evening. Fernwood describes this book as being structured around four particular Indigenous movements. The first one is the long-standing conflict with the Algonquins of Barrier Lake. Number two is the struggle against the Northern Gateway Pipeline. Number three is the Idle No More movement. And number four is the anti-fracking protests at Elsabooktuk First Nation in New Brunswick. By focusing their narrative around four specific Indigenous movements, they're able to organize their research around the specific experiences of Indigenous peoples in each of those movements. And I think for a general audience, this has a much greater appeal than trying to organize the massive ATIPs and thousands of documents in some other way. Not only do we learn about government surveillance around each of these movements, but we learn more about the movements themselves and the people that are in them. In the author's own words, and I quote, "This book provides extensive, first-hand accounts of how the security state has developed a prolific surveillance regime that targets Indigenous peoples as national security threats." They go on to explain, "We use first-hand accounts because we refer extensively to the records of police and security agencies to narrate this book. Compiled using thousands of declassified documents from dozens of government departments and hundreds of Access to Information Act requests, we believe this book is one of the most comprehensive accounts of contemporary government surveillance." Now, turning to my review of the book, all I can say is, wow. I mean, I have been working in Indigenous resistance and resurgence movements my entire life. Like my family, like my brothers and sisters. I mean, literally, my brothers and sisters and First Nations all over Turtle Island have personally experienced targeted surveillance and harassment by Canada's security regime. We know that we have been vilified as terrorists and threats to national security in the name of protecting the extractive industry and colonial government objectives. We know that our rights have been consistently violated without any real remedy. Despite living this and knowing this firsthand, this book still blew me away. To see it all meticulously documented in the government's own words, and to see each claim made by the authors, no matter how outrageous or unbelievable it sounded, was fully backed up by actual government documents. It was reaffirming, it was powerful, and to my mind, a damning comprehensive exposé on Canada's lawlessness when it comes to targeting Indigenous peoples. I appreciated how the authors went beyond their ATIP documents and included the voices of Indigenous activists and land defenders throughout Turtle Island. We heard from the Unistaten, the Inka Dene Alliance, the Wet'suwet'en, several warrior and youth societies, and individuals like Frida Hewson, Rusty Abbo, Teresa Spence, Derek Nepinak, Cindy Blackstock, Amanda Polchis, myself, and many others. I also think this book has the power to help educate Canadians about the true nature of their own government and offers the critical evidence needed to demand accountability and radical change. We all know that what the government does to us as Indigenous peoples can and will happen to Canadian citizens. And we've already seen it. We've seen it happen with Harper's Bill C-51, the so-called Anti-Terrorism Act, that violates the basic rights and freedoms of Canadians. And this is the same bill that Trudeau promised to repeal or amend and still hasn't. There is so much I want to say about this book, but I really, really want everyone to read it because it counters everything we have been taught in school and specifically challenges things like the so-called benevolent Mountie myth or the Canadian myth of peaceful colonization. Not only does this book make the point that traditional forms of indigeneity are cast as abnormal, but the elimination policies of the Canadian state have literally been normalized within society. It also brings home the fact that Canada, as an outlaw security state, is not a new problem, but it has its roots in colonization and the need of the colonizers to get rid of what they called the Indian problem. And what for? That was particularly to access our lands and resources. This book, when read in conjunction with numerous public inquiries and commissions into racism in the justice system, as well as the National Inquiry into Murdered and Missing Indigenous Women and Girls and their finding of both historic and ongoing genocide, leads to only one conclusion. Both surveillance and criminalization of Indigenous peoples goes hand in hand with genocide. In other words, it allows the violent elimination of Native peoples from our own lands. Now, I'm going to quote from the introduction of the book. Elimination thus serves a dual purpose: to suppress challenges to Canadian sovereignty and to facilitate access to the tremendous wealth and prosperity that can be accumulated through the theft of land. That quote literally says it all. All of this surveillance, all of this illegality, it's about stealing our lands and resources. As you can see, I'm going to be very hard-pressed to try to find some kind of substantive critique for this book. Now, I would love for the book to have been longer and covered more Indigenous movements. I would love for the book to have specifically outlined the shady history of the Royal Canadian Mounted Police in more detail, right from its beginnings as the Northwest Mounted Police to the numerous RCMP scandals and their links to the national crisis and genocide of murdered and missing Indigenous women and girls. But again, these are just wish lists. They're not actual critiques. My overall view of the book is that it should be mandatory reading for all students in high schools, colleges, universities, and any learning institution. I think this book is the most important book Canadians should read for 2020 because, as you can see, we are literally in the midst of RCMP lies, deceit, harassment, and arrests of Indigenous peoples all over Canada, standing in solidarity with the Wet'suwet'en Nation, defending their right to live on their lands and protect their water sources, plants, and animals, all within their own sovereign territory. This book literally speaks to what is happening right now, and we should all read it and then take action to demand accountability to end the injustice against Indigenous peoples. And in case you didn't know, the Surveillance Studies Network named Policing Indigenous Movements with the SSN Book Award for 2019. Congratulations to Andrew and Jeffrey and Fernwood Publishing. Now, let's move on to comments and questions from our Reconciliation Book Club members, because otherwise I'm going to go on all day about this book and then spoil it for everyone who hasn't read it yet. Now, Cluster Together, a loyal Reconciliation Book Club member, left their comments, and I quote, "This book made me wish for many changes in the world. The main change that I want to mention is my wish that critical thinking was taught in all schools right from the elementary level. I think that developing critical thinking skills and applying them to every news story that we are fed about Indigenous resistance would go a long way in stopping the perception of criminality of this resistance and would help gather many loud voices in support of Indigenous resistance to settler colonialism. This is such an important book, such an eye-opening book. Thanks for selecting this book to kick off 2020, Pam. Well, thank you, Cluster Together. I totally agree with you. How can Canadians know differently if they are not taught to question what they are taught in schools and what is essentially state propaganda versus actual historic fact? Another loyal Reconciliation Book Club member, Drew Indy 2, writes, "This book explains a lot. It all comes down to land and the economy." Well, you can say that again, Drew Indy 2. That is truly the crux of it all. Drew Indy 2 goes on to write, "More needs to be done to get the message out there that the Canadian government and security are treating Indigenous opposition as a crime against Canada's nationalism. The state has it all wrong. Indigenous peoples, especially their elders and knowledge keepers, have the answers to who we are supposed to be on Turtle Island, and this includes protecting the land, having all that we need, and promoting peace. Capitalism has to stop. We need to decolonize. I think that a lot more can be done soon to educate all people, not only children, and this is long overdue. Thank you for sharing your comments with everyone, Drew and D2. I completely agree with you. I don't think this is going to take 500 years. I think we can educate very quickly. Now, I have noticed that many of my readers will send their questions or comments on other social media sites because they're a little bit worried about offending people on this channel. Please don't worry about offending people. Send your comments, send your questions. That's how we all learn together. And I want to assure you that I do my best as the administrator for this YouTube channel for it to be a safe place to ask questions and engaged in fact-based discussions on what are really hard issues. I review comments and delete any racism or hatred, obvious trolls, and I delete anyone attacking anyone else who's commented. I really want open, honest discussions based on the facts so that we can all move forward in this decolonization project together. Thank you all for sending me your comments and suggestions. Please keep doing it. That's what makes this book club work. For those of you looking for more resources to complement these books in my book club, check out my website, www.pampalmiter.com. From there, you can also access my Warrior Life podcast, which has extended interviews with some of the authors that we cover in this book club. My blog, Indigenous Nationhood, covers current issues of the day in shorter articles and also on political and legal issues. You can also check out my other videos on YouTube that address some of the more difficult and legal political issues that we're currently facing, like the National Inquiry into Murdered and Missing Indigenous Women, for example. So be sure to subscribe and hit the notification button so you don't miss any of my videos. And now, for the moment that you've all been waiting for, what is going to be the next book in my Reconciliation Book Club? Well, I'm going to keep following my pattern and take us now back again in history to help us understand what's happening in the present. The next book is called The Unjust Society, and it was written by Harold Cardinal and published by Douglas and McIntyre and University of Washington Press. But here's the thing. It was originally published in 1969, but this is the updated version that has a new introduction by the author himself, Harold Cardinal. What I'll do is I'll put a link to this book below in the description box to make sure that we're all following along on the same version of the book. This next book review will be available on my YouTube channel on Sunday, February 23rd. That's really less than a month away because of today's date. Don't forget to leave me your questions, comments, and impressions in the comments section below this video for the next book. Thanks so much to all of you for participating in this Reconciliation Book Club. I will see you all back at the book club in a month.
And great news! Just before this video was uploaded to YouTube, Fernwood Publishing contacted me and is offering anyone who hasn't bought the book already a 20% off on the book. The discount code on their website is PIM20, and I'll post a link below in the description box that takes you right there. Thank you, Fernwood Publishing, for supporting my Reconciliation Book Club and for helping to educate all Canadians about these important Indigenous issues.